Welcome to our second live stream ever. We did one yesterday, we're doing one here today. We're in Dallas, Texas at the UnConference, our little family reunion where we get together to celebrate organizational health. And today we're gonna be talking about our book, The Ideal Team Player. So we wanna welcome everybody in TV land watching on their computers. And we're so glad to be here today. We're having a great time. So here's what I wanna say. I think it's time that we change the way we prepared people in our organizations and in society to be successful. I think we need to change the way we think about what success is, to focus less on technical and individual skills and more on other things. Today I'm gonna go over three very simple, really simple, but powerful virtues, attributes that I think can drastically change the success of any human being, whether they're the CEO of a company or whether they're a high school student or a middle manager or a middle schooler or a recent college grad who's just entering the workforce. I really believe that these three virtues can drastically change the trajectory of a person's success. And I'm confident in that because it's all based on the simple premise that life today, more than ever, is a team sport. Now that sounds like a cliche, like life is a team sport, you know what I mean? But it really is, because you think about it, in just the last like 30 years, which is not very long in the grand scheme of American or world history, and certainly in American business and our lives. I started working about 30 years ago. And at that time, we did not think about cooperating and teaming with people who worked on the other side of the world. A mountain range or an ocean or even a language or a culture was pretty much a barrier to cooperation. Today, we don't even think about that. And we can take that for granted, but that's largely because of technology. Technology now allows people to cooperate and collaborate and team in ways that they couldn't have done just 25, 30 years ago. Okay? So that's really important. And that same technology and the collaboration that goes with it allows people to develop solutions. Organizations develop solutions, whether it's in business or medicine or communication or finance, really complex solutions to problems that we couldn't have thought about 30 years ago. And those complex solutions, to implement them with our clients and with others, we have to collaborate, whether it's within an organization across departmental or divisional lines, or whether it's from one company to another across company lines. Even competitors today are finding themselves having to collaborate with one another just to implement all this stuff. So when we say that life is a team sport, we mean it. Even in our personal lives, teamwork is everywhere. I mean, when I think about, I have four boys, and I can't tell you, my wife and I like to say that by the time that each of them was in middle school, we have one middle schooler left, he's just about done, but by the time each of them was in middle school, they'd played on more teams, in more sports, with more coaches, and gone to more friggin' tournaments than she and I did in our lives combined. And many of you know what that's like if you're parents. And that's to say nothing about all the other extracurricular non-sports activities that they do in teams. Even in the classroom, it's amazing how much teamwork there is. My kids have come home from school so many times with a new assignment, right? And then they've said that dreaded four-word sentence. It's a group project. And we're like, oh no. And then we ask them that dreaded four-word question. Who's on your team? More than once I've said, son, if you want to get a good grade, you might just have to be prepared to do most of the work yourself. I mean, you know, the group project, there's other things that go on. I mean, everything, everywhere we live, teamwork is everywhere. And yet we're still largely training people at work and even in their young lives in education to be good at technical things individually. And I think we need to change that. And so that's what I want to talk to you about today. The three virtues that I think. And you know, we heard today from Southwest Airlines. And we heard from Anthony Lynn, the coach of the LA Chargers. And we've heard from Alan Mulally yesterday, the guy who turned around Ford. What did all these people say? They hire for their behavior. You can train for skill, okay? So what do you look for? Well, this book called The Ideal Team Player came about by accident. And I want to tell you about it because we didn't sit around one day and think, we should write a book about teamwork and have three words. Years ago, I wrote a book called The Five Dysfunctions of a Team, and that was 18 years ago. Well, thank you for clapping. That was very nice of you. This gentleman right here started the clapping. He was the crazy naked guy dancing, you know, in the video. Other people chimed in. Thank you. But anyway, so I wrote that book, and right after it came out, people would say, well, Pat, are some people better at doing this stuff than others? And I remember we were just busy and I was like, no, I think everybody can be a team player. Very few people just can't do it. But I didn't realize there was actually an answer to that question until years, and I had to think about something that happened before we even started the Table Group, our company. So years ago, when I worked at a software company, I had my own department there, and that was when the book by Jim Collins and Jerry Porras came out, God bless you, called Built to Last. It's a great book. And in Built to Last, they talked about core values, that great companies have core values. So we went out to get some of them our own, ourselves. So we went and went to a conference room at a hotel and got a whiteboard and a thesaurus and came up with some words to stand for our values. You've all been to these meetings, right? Unfortunately, many companies come up with like 12 words that encompass everything. And that doesn't really work because nobody has all 12. But we were fortunate that we came up with these three words, A, B, and C. And so we said, we're going to build our department around that. Then a few years later, that department and I, we went and started our own firm, The Table Group, what we do now, which is largely focused on helping organizations build better teams and more healthy organizations. And we took those three values with us. We said, we're going to build our company around that. And so we started our company, and we started working with these leadership teams. And in addition to helping them with teamwork and strategy and tactics, we'd help them with their values. And we'd say, so let's talk about what your company values will be. And they would say, oftentimes, what are your values, Pat? I said, well, we don't really broadcast them. It's really personal. You know. They'd say, but what are yours? And we'd say, well, here they are, A, B, and C. And they'd say, yeah, we like those. We're going to use those, too. And we'd say, no, you can't use those. You have to come up with your own values. We thought they were being lazy. Honestly, I thought, man, they just want to knock that one off the list. It wasn't that at all. There was something universally appealing about those values that I was just too slow to recognize until years later that we realized those were the three attributes that if a person had all three, that makes them an ideal team player. And that I should have known that because our whole firm was about teamwork, but we just didn't realize that. And so finally we did, and so we just told people about it. And a friend of mine said, you know something, you need to write a book about that. And I was like, I don't think that's a book. I mean, they're just three things, and they're really simple. He goes, no, that's a book. So I started writing a book. We're going to publish that book. And then I thought, maybe this is going to be the first book I write that's really bad. I mean, I'm not saying all my books are great, but I thought maybe this is the one that's going to really suck because it's so simple. So we put it out there, and that's pretty much how it always is when you put out a new book. And it sold faster, and people started using it faster than any book we'd ever written. And I think it's because it's so simple and because they can get their hands around it and use it. And we're going to talk about how to do that today. And so this is the ideal team player. We're going to talk about the three virtues. That's enough setup. Let's dive into it. All right. The three virtues of an ideal team player. The first one, now by the way, this is so ridiculously simple, I have to tell you that. The key here isn't the virtues themselves, it's the combination of all three. But now that I've said that, let's dive in and look at the first one. The first one is if you want to be an ideal team player, you have to be humble. Humility is critical. Sounds very obvious, but here's the thing. Most people think of humility, and rightly so, as not being arrogant or egotistical or self-centered. A humble person is other-centered, more concerned about the greater good than themselves. That is the right definition. By the way, if the root of all sin in the Bible, which I believe, is pride, the antidote to pride is humility. So it stands to reason that this is really important. This is by far the most important of the three virtues. But I want to tell you this. There's actually another aspect of humility that people get wrong. And that is sometimes we look at a person and we say, gee, Brad is, he never stands up for himself. He never thinks he has the right answer. He never calls any attention to himself. And he always gives in a conversation or a discussion. He's really humble. And that's actually a violation of humility. Because you see, to deny your God-given talents or ideas is no more humble than to exaggerate them. If you have a good idea, standing up for that is a sign of humility because it's about truth. C.S. Lewis, you know, from the Chronicles of Narnia, he once said that humility is not thinking less of yourself, it's thinking about yourself less. And so one of the things we have to realize is humility is not denying who you are and what you're good at. Humility is just not exaggerating it and wanting to use that for others. So humility, now, I think that arrogance and self-centeredness and ego are the biggest and most common forms of a person who lacks humility. But I just wanted to explain the nuance of the other side of that too. So humble, the most important of them. The second virtue of an ideal team player is you have to be hungry. Hungry is pretty straightforward. A hungry person is one who works really hard and has very high standards, strong work ethic, never does just the minimum, goes above and beyond. Okay? Very straightforward. Now, I will say this. When I work with young people, I often tell them, this one is the simplest to understand, might be one of the harder ones to develop later in life. There's something about learning this early. So I was with a group of middle schoolers the other day in my son's classroom going through this. And we were like, so start working hard now, whether it's in your class, whether it's at home, whether it's in the sports you play or their extracurriculars. Learn to do that because later on, you just don't turn it on. And one kid in there, I'll save that till later. Hey, look at that, a moment of self-restraint. Okay, humble, hungry. The third one is smart. To be a great team player, you also have to be smart. Now, that sounds really obvious, but this one is not what you think. Smart is not intellectually smart. It's emotionally intelligent. It's common sense around people. That basically, you're in a room, and you know that how your words or actions are going to affect how other people are and how they feel. You're going to notice when somebody might be upset, and you're going to know how to interact with them. Emotional intelligence, if you will, although it's really just common sense around interpersonal behaviors. Humble, hungry, and smart. These are the three simple virtues. Now, the thing about it is, if in baseball, if you're 1-for-3 at the plate, you have a pretty good batting average. 333 is a very good batting average. In humble, hungry, and smart, it's bad. It's bad. In football, if you're a quarterback and you complete two out of three passes, you're 2-for-3, that's really good. It's still not very good in teamwork. The key here is this. All of us need to aspire to really have all three. Now, none of us are perfect. We all struggle with one or more at one time or another for a short period of time. But if you egregiously lack even one of these, it can create big problems on your ability to work on a team and be successful. And so, I have to tell you, I talk to my kids about this now. I ask them, so how are you doing on your third one? We're going to talk more about that in a second. If even one is lacking, it can really hold you back. So the idea is to go 3-for-3. So here's what I want to do. I want to help you understand how to do two things. First, how to develop this in yourself and others. And secondly, how to go about hiring for people that have this. Okay, because that's the two applications. You've got people that work for you on a team and in yourself, and we got to dance with who brung you, you know, and we got to deal with that and ourselves too. But then when we hire other people, boy, it would be great if we could do that in a way. If you hire people that are humble, hungry, and smart, that really changes everything. Okay, so let's go forward and let's learn first to identify people who are 1-for-3 or 2-for-3. 0-for-3, and I don't mean this in a humorous way. They're probably not interviewing at your company. You're probably not meeting a lot of these people because they are really struggling in life. And God help them, because if you have none of these virtues, there's not a lot of promise going on in your life. But if you're 1-for-3, sometimes we run into people like this, and sometimes we can even relate to it. Let's say that you're just humble, the most important of the virtues, but you're not hungry or smart, okay? So you have the most important one, which might make you a dear human being, but you don't have a strong work ethic and you're not good with dealing with people. We call this the pawn. The pawn is a person who only gets things done when somebody moves them on the board and tells them what to do. They're not going to initiate things on their own. They're not going to do a lot of extra stuff. I don't even want to talk too much about this because there's not that many pawns in the world that you run across, but this is what a person is that is just humble. Now, what about a person who's just hungry? They're not humble and they're not smart. They just really hardworking. We call this the bulldozer. Here's the thing about a bulldozer. You see them coming from a mile away. They get a lot done, and they drive right over other people in doing it. The good news is you can tell. Most people don't survive in an organization when they're humble. Look at this woman taking my picture, crawling around over there. You could just stand up and walk around. How are you doing? What's your name?
Christina.
Christina's taking pictures for us, many pictures of you. Thank you, Christina, for what you're doing. She was in pain. She was crawling around back there. Get a shot of Christina on the camera, would you please? Thank you. Okay, so what the heck was I talking about? The bulldozer. Bulldozers, they tend to survive if they run their own company, because they don't fire themselves, or if they're in a field like in sales and they always make their number and the people that manage them don't realize the negative impact they have on others. But mostly bulldozers don't succeed in life. Okay, what about a person who's not humble or hungry, but they're really smart about dealing with people? We call that the charmer. I call this the Ferris Bueller in life. Remember, if you've seen Ferris Bueller, that movie? This is a person who's fun to be around or entertaining, but they're not really into others and they don't really work hard. They're not humble or hungry, but you can kind of deal with them because they will entertain you for a while. Okay, the one for threes is not the group that we need to be most worried about. It's the two for threes, because most of us can relate to being two for three or have worked with other people that are. So let's take a look at that. What about somebody who's humble? So they're really about others, that's the most important. And they're hungry, they work really hard, they go above and beyond, they have a strong work ethic. Man, I have a lot of time for people who are humble and hungry. But they're just not interpersonally smart. They don't have a lot of EQ sometimes. They don't really know what to say. We call this the accidental messmaker. The accidental messmaker is that person, I think of them like a puppy, okay? Really great person, they mean well, lots of energy, but you gotta clean up after them. They knock things over, they poop on the carpet, and you're constantly saying, it's a good dog. You just have, you wrap them on the nose with a newspaper. You know, we do that at work with the accidental messmakers. You know, you wrap them on the nose, and they're like, I'm sorry, I didn't mean it. We know you had good intentions, but they create a little extra work for you. Now, I have a lot of time for accidental messmakers, but they do create extra work and can sometimes make things a little harder. So if you can help an accidental messmaker develop emotional intelligence, you'd go a long way, okay? So that's the first type. How about the person that's two for three? They're humble and they're smart. So they're really humble and they're smart. They're just not very hardworking. Okay, we call this the lovable slacker. The lovable slacker. The lovable slacker, the problem with them is they're lovable. So it's fun to be around them. And they mean well and they care about other people, but you're just constantly reminding them you have to do more. And they're really good about saying, I know, I really should, shouldn't I? And then 6 months later, you're like, you're still doing that. And they go, I know, isn't it terrible? You know, I feel really bad. But then they still don't do that. The problem is, I know as an ENFP, I told you before that I'm kind of a wuss. It's hard to move on and act a lovable slacker because they're such a wonderful person. The lovable slacker, though, creates more work for the people around them and really frustrates people with a strong work ethic because it makes them feel like, if this guy or this gal can survive and not work hard, maybe I shouldn't either. So there is a cost to having a lovable slacker. Okay, how about somebody who is hungry, really hardworking, and smart, really good with people, but they're not humble? This is the most dangerous kind. This is what we call the skillful politician. The skillful politician is that person who, because they're smart, they're interpersonally savvy, and they're ambitious and hardworking, they know how, through their smarts, God bless you, they know how to hide their lack of humility. They interview well, they say the right things at meetings. You think, this guy's awesome, but you just don't know what's going on. Once I worked with a lovable slacker at a company, and we thought this guy was fantastic, because he always said the right things at meetings, he seemed to have a great attitude, but he was so clever in hiding his lack of humility. See, because he was Canadian, and nobody suspected a Canadian as lacking humility, right? Like, he wouldn't be a skillful, he's a Canadian. And so we were like, this is the best guy ever. And one day we realized, oh my gosh, all his colleagues have gotten fired. He's making 10 times more money. He's been gaming us. And then we looked around and there were dead bodies hidden in closets all throughout the organization. This is that kid. I went over this model with my 17-year-old son, Casey. And it was one of the coolest things because he was in my office and he saw this on the board. They don't read my books, you know. I mean, the older ones, some do now. But Casey's like a junior in high school. And he looked up and he saw this model. And he was like, Dad, that's dope. Which means it's good. That's a good thing now. And I said, what do you mean? He goes, that's everything. Those three things that I can go through my friends. My favorite friends have all three of those. My teammates in lacrosse have all three of those. Even in class, I can see people that have those. See, this having those three things, and he was able to spot young people that were skillful politicians. He said, that guy kisses up to the coach. The coach doesn't realize yet, it's all about him. So it's an amazing thing to watch young people see this and go, yeah, I know exactly what that means. Okay? All right, so humble, hungry, and smart. We gotta have all three. We gotta avoid being those. So what do we do? How do we go about developing our team members and ourselves to become ideal team players? And maybe our kids or the kids on the teams that we coach. How do we do that? God bless you. Excuse me. Once again, allergies. Okay. So here's what we have to do. Here's what we have to do. First, we have to apply it to ourselves. So if you're the leader of a team, the first thing you have to do is really go through those three virtues and say, which of them do I struggle with? So here's an exercise that we're gonna take everybody here in Dallas through, and the people on the live stream, we'd love you to do it afterward, after we close down the live stream. We want you to sit down with your team, first apply it to yourself and be really critical, like which of these three is my third out of three? And then have everybody else do that too. Rank yourself first, second, and third. Which one am I naturally good at? Which one do I struggle with? And which one do I struggle with the most? Even if you're good at all three, you're gonna have a third. Even if you're not so good at any of them, you're gonna have a third. Let's just focus on everybody calling out their third out of three. So once you do that, then what you have to do, help them identify theirs. So you have that session, I think I just jumped ahead of myself. Help them identify theirs. It's an amazing thing to watch. I've done it with executives of big companies. I've done it with small teams, small organizations. I've done it with kids and college athletes, high school kids, middle schoolers in the classroom. It is amazing to watch people go, I know that I lack humility, and here's why. Or I know that I'm not that smart, and here's why. And when everybody on the team has done that, everybody's sitting around looking at each other, then what you do is you brainstorm with them, and you help people realize, you say, okay, she lacks humility. What advice would you give her? She just called it out herself, and people are like, maybe you could talk about other people more than yourself and ask questions more. Or maybe you can not always bring the attention to yourself. Or that person lacks hunger. And they say, you know, when you leave at night from the job, maybe you could check in with people and see if there's not some things you could help other people with rather than checking out early. Or she lacks smarts, self-evaluated. Say, maybe after every meeting, we can give you some advice about how things went in the meeting if you missed something and might have frustrated somebody without knowing it. Suddenly, you've turned all of your colleagues into coaches. And you've not only given them permission, you've exhorted them to tell you how you can get better. It's an amazing thing to watch. I've seen kids on a lacrosse team go, oh, I'm not humble. I score a goal, I don't thank the person who passed me the ball. It's too much about me and my stats. I should stop that. And the other kids on the team are like, so you know you do that? And they go, oh yeah, I do. I don't wanna do that anymore. Or the other kid, I had a goalie on the team once say, yeah, I'm not smart. I yell, I just scream at guys when they make a mistake. Makes them feel bad, it makes them play worse. That's really stupid of me. And they're like, yeah, you do that. And so when you do that, we'll call you on it. He goes, yeah, please do that. And so you see these kids going around and going, hey, that wasn't very smart, you know? It's an amazing thing to watch people start to teach each other these things at any age. Now, the last thing we have to do, and this is where we as leaders have to do this, we have to constantly remind people whenever we see them violate one of the values that they've said they want to get better at. So I, as a leader, when I see Casey do something that violates the value that he said is his third, I have to constantly remind him. Now, let me tell you, though, that's not easy. Most leaders don't like to do it. I don't like to do it. Now, the first time Casey says, okay, I'm not very humble, and then I see him do something that lacks humility, I'm going to go right to Casey and I'm going to tell him. And then a week goes by and I see him do it again. You know what I do? I go right to my wife and I tell her. I can't believe he did it again. He does it again. This time I go right to my colleagues and I say, can you believe he's still doing that? I mean, this is a very natural thing and a very dangerous thing. I have to go to him and go, Casey, you need to do it. You know, most people, when they get called on things enough, they change their behavior. But they can't do that if we're not willing to call them on it. Sometimes you remind them for the 10th time and they decide they can't change their behavior, but they decide I need to work someplace else where I can actually be more like that because it's not working out here. Very rarely when we constantly remind people about how to get better do we have to fire them. It's when we don't talk to them and help them that they neither improve nor opt out on their own. So this is a huge thing, but most of the time, and the best case scenario, is that they just get better because you've actually taken the time to remind them. I can't tell you how many people have gone through that exercise and nobody has ever said to them, we know you have an issue in this and we want to help you. It's crazy to watch that happen. Okay, so that's how we develop our teams. What about hiring? Well, I really believe we need to change the way we hire. Even now, We all know that what Coach Lynn said about, you know, we and the people at Southwest Airlines, hire for attitude, train for skill, but man, it's a lot easier to look for skill on a resume. And Bobby Herrera, who's one of the folks that was up here last year, likes to talk about when he interviews people, he turns the resume over and writes notes on the back about their behaviors. He doesn't want to look at the experience. He doesn't look at the technical skills. He wants to talk about who they are. So how do we do that? Well, the first thing we have to do is, I just said this, didn't we? We have to stop focusing on the technical skills. And now, granted, if they're a brain surgeon, they're flying an airplane, they got to have the requisite technical skills. And if Coach Lynn is not going to guide, hey, this guy's 5'2" and he weighs 130 pounds. He has a great attitude, though. I think he'll make a great running back. No, he's going to get killed in his first game. But that's the easy part. The behavioral stuff is most important. So we have to do that. Here's the next thing. We just got to change the way we interview people. And even though I remember hearing this 25 years ago, most interviews still work the same way. And that's people go sit down behind a desk, cross their legs, and answer questions about their resume. And the problem is, and Coach Lynn said this too, the players, they've been prepped. Even these college kids that are going to, they've been prepped by their agents how to do this. Most of us know how to fake it in, through an interview, right? Unfortunately, people aren't like the stepbrothers in their interview that we watched today. So what do we have to do when we improve our interview? And the first thing we have to do is we got to have some non-traditional interviews. Let's start getting people into an environment where we can see what they're really like, not in a rehearsed way. I like to say, take them shopping, preferably for underwear. I mean, you know, like, hey, can you go pick out some briefs for my son's like 13. See what you think will work, you know? Take them to run errands with you. Take them, if you coach Little League, help me run a practice. You know what a lot of people say is the best way to interview is to fly across country with somebody and back. And by the time you get back, you're going to know if you should work for them. And people go, but I don't have the time or the money for that. And I think, yeah, you shouldn't do that. But that would be better than hiring the wrong person. You know, I mean, it would be better than hiring the wrong person. So how about just getting them out of the office and say, we're going to go do something uncustomary because I want to see how you act around people. Okay? I really believe we should do that. You know, I want some... A good friend of mine, she has a business, and she actually runs this Bible study that my wife does, and it's huge. It's nationwide. It's for women, and it's a great organization, and she needed to hire somebody, and she was desperate. You know that whole thing, like, oh, we're dying here. We're desperate. So she found somebody that had the skills and was willing to take the job. They did a very cursory interview. You know that interview when you're desperate where you're rooting for the person? Like, you're not a bad person, are you? You're not weird. No, 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 yeah, good, I thought so. And you're like, you're in. And they hired this person. A year later, they were paying her a large severance to leave. Two of her executives had quit because of this. And you know what my friend told me? She said, Pat, if I had taken her shopping, I'd have seen it all. If I'd had just taken her shopping. You know, we have to put in more time and energy and creativity in how we find the right people. And it's just not going to happen, no matter how intuitive we think we are. You know, the CEO of Charles Schwab years ago, I don't know what his name was, but he would do this. God bless you. He would actually invite people to breakfast when he interviewed them. And he'd get there early, and he'd tell the server to mess up their order because he wanted to see how they would deal with that. How are they going to cope with this? And I, you know, the point is, I want to see how somebody really is. And so we got to interview that way. Here's the next one. We got to ask questions more than once. Too often we go to interview, and again, that thing like, so, are you an axe murderer? No? Good, good. Like anybody's going to tell us their worst things, right? We have to ask questions more than once. And if you're not sure that a person has those core values, Southwest Airlines, when they interview somebody, and did you hear what they said today? They said, we interview them as long as we need to until we know they're a fit. It's not like, well, they went through the third round of interviews. We're not sure yet, but they got through it, so we'll hire them. No, they're like, we got to know. And so if you have a doubt in your mind about somebody, or this is not my mind, in your gut, more importantly, body oblivion, you know. If you have a doubt about somebody, do not just go, well, that's the best I can do. Keep asking, keep probing. I call it the Law and Order School of Interviewing. Have you ever seen Law and Order? You know, ka-kung, that show. It always works this way, right? They're like, hey, did you kill him? No. Did you kill him? No. Did you kill him? Yeah, okay, I killed him. The third time, they always admit it, like, I thought so. So ask questions three times. I was once interviewing a guy, and a really good guy, but I didn't think he fit our culture because I'm Italian and we wanted humility. And I just had this sense that he wasn't a forgiving guy. And my boss, this was before I started my firm, she wanted me to hire him. He'd be a great hire. Even the people that I worked with that worked for me said, I think he'd be great. But I had this feeling like, I don't know that I'm ever going to be able to go there with him. And so I went to my last formal interview with him, and I sat down with him and I said, how do you deal, forgiveness is important and it's about conflict and forgiveness. And I said, how do you deal with conflict? Well, so that's a softball, you know, question. What's he going to say? He said, oh, I have conflict. I'm fine with conflict. I was like, yeah, I wasn't sure. So later I said, hey, if you get an argument with your friends, how do you come back from that? Is that difficult? No, I'm fine with that. But I didn't think it was, you know, if my gut told me he's right, that's true. I knew there was something, and I was like, oh, I got to figure this out. And so I said to him, and this is also a good thing, ask somebody what somebody else would say about them. It's harder for them to not tell the truth about that, and they're always a little worried that you're going to ask that person. And I said to this guy, I said, hey, Brad, what would your wife say if I asked her if you were a grudge holder? And he said, oh, she'd say I'm a huge grudge holder. So I pulled that little lever in my office, and he slid right down the chute, you know. But I just knew it. And it wasn't that I'm just asking questions for fun. I really wanted to know, and I had this sense. And it was the best thing. I have to tell you a story. That guy was in the audience once when I told that story. And he came up to me afterward and sucked me in the face. No, he didn't actually at all. It just wasn't going to be a fit for him, right? And so if we're looking for something, humble, hungry, or smart, or your core values, you've got to interview in a way that you're sure that you've really done your best to make sure that they're gonna fit. The last thing is this. I think we should scare people with sincerity. Scaring somebody with sincerity goes like this. So you're about to hire them, and you think they're a good fit, but just for good measure, you're going to go to them and say, listen, Brad, here's the deal. We're crazy about customers here. Imagine you're at Southwest Airlines or Nordstrom. We love customers here. You know, they're going to throw up on your feet, and they're going to make a mess on the plane, or they're going to try to return a shirt that they clearly destroyed themselves, and they're going to want you to return it and be nice to them about it. Here's the thing, Brad. I think you're going to like working here, but if you don't like that kind of stuff and you wouldn't enjoy dealing with people like that, you shouldn't work here because you're not going to like it and we're not going to like you. And so I just want to make sure. Now, we think you'll probably be a good fit, but that's how we really are. We're really sincere about this. So do you still want to work here? Invite them. We should date like that, too. It's like, here, you should know this. I grind my teeth. I snort when I laugh. And check this, I smell sometimes really bad. If that's a problem, let's make sure we get that taken care of now and you can go find somebody else. I mean, we shouldn't be trying to convince them to work for us and we shouldn't be trying to let them convince us. We should be telling them the truth. Scare them with sincerity. If we do those things, and I think if you can find people that are humble, hungry, and smart, if your organization depends on teamwork, it's gonna make life a lot easier. I really believe that if, you know, when we hire people at my company, we don't care what their GPA or their SAT or their ACT was. The only three-letter acronym we really care about is HHS. And I'm convinced that if more people, I think the world would be better. I think organizations would be better. I think families would be better. And I think individuals, even you, Brad, would be better if more people were humble, hungry, and smart. Thank you for listening. Thank you for joining us. Performance and attitude of your team, and I mean drastically, in just 1 hour. If you're a college or high school coach, or for that matter, the leader of any team of young people, this program is designed specifically for you. I hope
hope that you'll take advantage of this program and achieve for your team a competitive advantage. And in the process, give your team members life skills that are going to make them more competitive and successful for years to come.